A very good afternoon to all the students. In this session, we are going to discuss a topic on the Chinese remainder theorem. So, in short form, we will call this Chinese remainder theorem as CRT. Right? We have two different applications of the CRT, which we will discuss at the end of the session. And let us start the discussion on the Chinese remainder theorem. What is this and what for we are going to use this Chinese remainder theorem? All these things we will discuss, right? Are you able to see the screen, right?
You are now unmuted.
So the Chinese remainder theorem is used to solve a set of congruent equations. So you should know what a congruent equation is. We know that a symbol has been introduced in the modular arithmetic, which is nothing but the congruent, which is represented with three parallel lines, right? So this is a symbol which is equal to, right? In equal to, we will write it as the two parallel lines, but in the modular arithmetic, you have to express it in terms of congruence, right? So this is nothing but equal to symbol. We can assume that it is a equal to symbol. So this CRT theorem is used to solve a set of congruent equations. So this is one congruent equation. X is congruent to A1 mod M1. And the second equation is X is congruent to A2 mod M2. And the third equation is X is congruent to A3 mod M3. Like that, we have any number of expressions like this. And if you observe these congruent equations, you can see here that the variable is common, right? So we have only one variable. This CRT theorem is not used to solve equations which are having multiple variables. Only one variable will be there, and the variable is denoted in these expressions as X. But different moduli, this is also very important. So here M1 is one moduli, and this is M2 is another modulus, and M3 is another modulus. Like that, we have MN, that means N number of modulus we have. These M1, M2, M3 and so on up to MN are different. That is the reason why we are saying that these moduli are different. And one more important point you should remember in this Chinese remainder theorem is, all these modulus are relatively prime to each other, right? So what do you mean by relatively prime? Do you have any idea that about this relatively prime concept?
Their GCD will be 1.
Super. So if you take two numbers A and B, and if you find the GCD of A and B, if the GCD is equal to 1, then we say that A and B are relatively prime to each other, right? So coming back to our Chinese remainder theorem, as I told that this M1, M2, M3 and so on are different modulus values, but you should remember that these modulus are relatively prime to each other. Very important point. Without having these M1, M2, M3 and so on up to MN, that means the modulus values, if they are not relatively prime, then CRT theorem will not be applied. Very important concept, right? So this CRT theorem is used to solve a set of congruent equations. These are the set of congruent equations with one common variable, that is X, and different moduli, that is M1, M2, M3 and so on up to MN. And another point you should remember is that these modulus values are relatively prime to each other, right? So if you have such type of equations, congruent equations, then we have an unique solution. Only one solution will be there. X will not have multiple values. It will have only one value. And this is satisfied. That means X is having a unique solution is satisfied if and only if the moduli are relatively prime. This is very important concept in CRT, right? So is it clear?
Right,
So the CRT algorithm is used to solve a set of congruent equations with only one variable and different moduli, which are relatively prime to each other. Simple topic. So if we are done with this particular introduction part, let us go and discuss the concept of Chinese remainder theorem. How we can solve it? How we can solve for the variable x? So these are the various steps that we need to follow in the Chinese remainder theorem. You will be given a list of congruences on different moduli. So we have x is congruent to a1 mod m1, x is congruent to a2 mod m2, and so on up to, this is also x, it's not xk, right? And x is equal to ak mod mk. So we have k number of congruent equations. The first step what we have to do for this type of equations is you have to find a common modulus which is represented with the uppercase letter M. So the equation for finding out the common modulus uppercase M is equal to, you have to product all the modulus from different equations. So M is given as M1 multiplied with M2 multiplied with M3 and so on multiplied with MK. Very simple step. Once you are done with the common modulus, once you have identified the common modulus, then you have to go to step 2. In step 2, you have to find the values of M1, M2 and so on up to MK. Here M, this M is different from this modulus, right? So here we are representing with uppercase M, where we can calculate the value of M1 is equal to common modulus by modulus of the first equation. And the uppercase M2 is calculated by common modulus divided by the modulus value of second equation. Like that, you have to find the MK value also. MK is given as common modulus M by the modulus value of the kth equation, that is MK. Once we have completed the calculations of these M1, M2 and so on up to MK, then the third step is you have to find the inverses of the M1, M2 and so on up to MK. So we represent the inverse like this, M1 superscripted with minus 1. This is called as the inverse of M1. Similarly, the inverse of M2 is represented as M2 superscript minus 1. Like that, you have to find various inverses of M1, M2 and so on up to MK. Inverse means, as we know that we have two types of inverses. One is the additive inverse and the second one is the multiplicative inverse. Here we are not bothered about the additive inverse. We are going to concentrate only on the multiplicative inverses. Right. So M1 inverse is nothing but the multiplicative inverse of M1. M2 inverse is the multiplicative inverse of the M2. Like that you have to follow. Right. So how we are going to calculate this M1 inverse, M2 inverse, that we'll do it when we are dealing with one particular problem. Right. So we'll be finding out this M1 inverse with M1 and modulus value. Similarly, M2 inverse is calculated by making use of the uppercase M2 and the modulus value lowercase M2. We'll see what a simple formula will be there. Nothing to worry, right? And the final step, once you are done with the common modulus calculation and the individual modulus calculations like M1, M2 and M3 and so on up to MK, and after finding out this M1 inverse, M2 inverse and so on, the final step is you have to find the value of x. So the value of x is given by a simple formula, that is a1 multiplied with M1 multiplied with M1 inverse plus a2 multiplied with M2 and multiplied with M2 inverse plus and so on up to AK multiplied with MK inverse, and finally you have to use modulus of common modulus capital M. So a very simple problem we have with this Chinese remainder theorem, but this is used to solve a set of congruence equations, which you will be using it in the concept of cryptography. That is the reason why we are going to discuss this Chinese remainder theorem in depth. So is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
So the first step is to find the common modulus m. The second step is to find the moduluses of m1, m2 and so on up to mk. The third step is finding the multiplicative inverses of m1, m2 and so on up to mk, which are denoted by m1 inverse, m2 inverse and so on up to mk inverse. And finally, the fourth step is related to calculation of the variable x, where x is given by a1 into m1 multiplied with m1 inverse plus a2 multiplied with m2 multiplied with m2 inverse and so on, ak multiplied with mk multiplied with mk inverse mod capital M. So if it is clear, we'll deal with some of the problems, right? Shall I proceed?
You are now unmuted.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So let us go with the first example. We are given a set of equations, congruent equations. So the congruent equation will be in the form x is congruent to a mod m. So let us assume that in the problem they have given three congruent modulo equations. X is congruent to 2 mod 3. Similarly, we have another equation, x is congruent to 3 mod 5, and the third equation is x is congruent to 2 mod 7. So these are the three equations that we are given, and we need to find the value of x. Clearly this is a Chinese remainder theorem, right? But before you proceed to give the solution or to give the value of x, you should check the values of the modulus. What are the values of modulus? We have three modulus values. One is 3, 5 and 7. Are they relatively prime or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, right. If you find the GCD of 3 and 5, we have 1. If you find the GCD of 5 and 7, we have 1. And if you find the GCD of 3 and 7, we have 1. The concept here is when we have a single prime number, for example, I'm considering the relatively prime. I'm taking two values, right? A and B. In order to identify the relative primeness between this A and B, you have to find the GCD of A comma B, which is equal to 1. We have some simple tricks here, right? So if any of these values A and B is prime, then obviously the GCD of that prime number with any other number will be 1, right? No need to worry. But if both the numbers are prime, obviously they are relatively prime. So those are the simple tricks. There are a lot of properties related to this relatively prime, but for our discussion we require two important properties, that if both the numbers are prime, then they are definitely relatively prime to each other. Or else, in the second case, if any of the number is prime, forget about the second number. If any of the number is prime, then that is relatively prime to every other number. These are the two important points you should understand, right? Now let us start our solution. What is that we have to find? What is the output we should have? We need to find the value of x. Am I right or not?
We're now unmuted.
Yes, sir. Yes,
so
sir.
What is the value of a1 here? A1 means this is first equation, which is denoted as x congruent a1 mod m1. So a1 is 2. What is the value of a2? That is related to the second equation. What is the value of
a2?
We're now on 3, sir.
3. What is the value of a3?
2, sir.
2. What is the first modulus value, lowercase m1? It is 3. And the second modulus is m2 is equal to 5. and the third modulus M3 is equal to 7. Right. So according to Chinese remainder theorem, what is step 1? We have to find the common modulus M, where M is given by M1 multiplied with M2 multiplied with M3. So what is the value of M I have? 3 multiplied with 5 multiplied with 7. What is this value? Please tell me. 15 into 7. 105. Is it clear up to this first step?
First step.
You are now unmuted.
Yes, sir.
Right. What is step 2? You have to find the values of M1, M2 and M3. Since we have three equations.
Since we have three.
Where M1 is given by M by M1. What is the common modulus I got here? It is 105. By what is the first value? M1, that is 3. What is 105 by 3?
35, sir.
35. Now, what about M2? M2 is given by M by M2. 105 by, what is the value of M2? It is 5. What is this value?
21, sir.
21. And M3 is given by M by M3. That is equal to 105 by 7. What is the value?
15, sir.
Super, 15. So we are done with second step. What is step 3? Finding the multiplicative inverses, that is M1 inverse and M2 inverse and M3 inverse. Right. So how do you find the inverse? How do you find the inverse? Multiplicative inverse. Actually, the procedure is you have to multiply this M1 with some value. For example, 35 multiplied with some value x should result in 1. That is what we mod M1. Right? So this is what the multiplicative inverse is actually. So when 35 is multiplied with some value which results in the remainder of 1, then we say that x and 35 are multiplicative inverses to each other. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now tell me what happens to the M1 inverse. So what is M1? 35, right? So 35 into some value x should be equivalent to 1 when it is modulo operated with M1. What is M1? What is
smaller
M1? 3. So when I multiply 35 with x and divide it with 3, I should get a remainder 1. So what is the value of x here? 3, sir. If I put 1 here, 35 into 1 by 3, what is the remainder? It is 2, right? So this is not satisfied. Now you put the value of 1, not 1, 2. 35 2s are 70, 70 by 3, what is the remainder? 70 by 3, what is the remainder?
1, sir.
1. So here, the 2 is satisfying this property. That means when I multiply this 35 with 2 modulo operated with 3, then I get the remainder 1. Therefore, I can say that 35 and 2 are the inverses to each other, multiplicative inverses to each other. But we have a very simple formula. Don't go about this one. So we have a simple formula where if I want to find the M1 inverse, you can simply find it out by making use of M1 mod M1. So this M1 is calculated from step 2 and this M1 is the input that is given by the user, modulus value. So let us find out M1 inverse. What is capital M1 we have? 35, right?
35
mod first modulus value is 3. What is that? I will get the remainder. 35 mod 3?
2, sir.
3 will go 11 times, 3 11s are 33, therefore 2 is the remainder. Therefore, 2 is the multiplicative inverse. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Now, if I want to find the M2 inverse, it is given by the formula M2 mod modulus M2. So, what is the value of capital M2 I have? It is 21. 21 mod, what is the second modulus value? 5. So, what is that output I will get here?
1, sir.
1. Similarly, calculating M3 inverse. M3 inverse is given by M3 mod M3. This one. So, capital M3, I got it as 15. 15 mod, what is the modulus value M3 here? It is 7. So, 15 mod 7, what is the value?
1, sir.
So, I am done with this M1 inverse, M2 inverse and M3 inverse. Now, finally, the final step I am writing here. You can see here, right? Step 4. Step 4 is to calculate the value of X which is given by A1 multiplied with M1 multiplied with M1 plus M1 inverse this is. A2 multiplied with M2 multiplied with M2 inverse plus A3 multiplied with M3 multiplied with M3 inverse. Now tell me what is the value. So what is A1 here? Two, right?
Yes,
2 multiplied with what is capital M1? 35. 35 multiplied with M1 inverse, it is 2. Plus, what is the value of A2? 3. 3 multiplied with capital M2, which is 21. Multiplied with M2 inverse, which is 1. Plus, what is the value of A3? 2. 2 multiplied with capital M3, which is 15. Multiplied with M3 inverse, which is 1. So, what is the resultant value I will get here? So, this entire thing should be again multiplied with mod capital M, right? Now tell me, 235, 70, 140, this is 140 plus 63 plus 30. So, what is the value I will get here?
Yeah, I
will
get here.
233.
233. Mod, what is the value of capital M? 105. Now tell me, what is the result I will get here? So, 105 goes 2 times. So, 2 into 105 is 210. Right. So, the remainder is, so the remainder I got is 23. So, this is the value of X. Is it clear?
We're now on
music. Right. So, this is how we need to solve the set of congruent equations using the Chinese remainder theorem. We'll go with two more examples. This is a direct problem that was given here. So, x is, three equations are direct equations. X is congruent to 2 mod 3. X is congruent to 3 mod 5. X is congruent to 2 mod 7. So, we follow the steps and you find out the value of X. This is what the Chinese remainder theorem is useful for. We will see another example, the second example, where you are not given the direct equations. Example 2. You will be given a statement, right? For example, what the problem is given as? Listen here. Let me write the problem. Find an integer that has 3 as remainder when divided by 7 and 13 but is divisible by 12. So this is the statement that is given, and you need to find the integer satisfying this particular conditions, right? So by looking at this particular statement, can I write this one? So what the author is saying, you have to find an integer. Let us say that integer is x. So if that integer has remainder 3 when it is divided by 7 and 13, right? So can I write the statement like this? First equation, x is congruent to 3 mod 7. Am I right or not? So when a value x is modulo operated with 7, I am getting the remainder 3. How can I write the second statement? Anybody please respond. How can I write the second statement? The other is saying that integer has the remainder 3 when it is divided by 7 and 13 also. So can I write the second statement as x is congruent to 3 mod 13?
Yes, sir.
Right. Is there any other equation we have, or shall we stop it? He has given another thing, this one. But it is divisible by 12. That means x is exactly divisible by 12. What is the remainder when an integer is exactly divisible by a number? Divisibility means you will get no remainder. That means the remainder is 0. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
So what should I write here? What is the equation, equivalent equation? X is congruent to, what is the remainder?
0, sir.
0. 0 I got when it is multiplied with 12. So shall I write it like x is congruent to 0 mod 12?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now we have 3 congruent equations. And 3 modulus, 3 different modulus. This is very important. Modulus plays very important role. They should be different and they should be relatively prime. Now check whether 17, 13 and 12 are relatively prime or not. Prime is different from relatively prime. Prime is a condition that is checked on a single number. Relatively prime is a condition that is checked on two numbers. So if you take 7 and 13, are they relatively prime or not? Remember the first condition, if both of them are prime, then they are definitely relatively prime. So 7 and 13 are prime, they are definitely prime. And compare this 13 and 12, are they relatively prime? Go for my second condition, what I told in the previous discussions. So if one number is a prime number, then if it is combined with any other number, they will be definitely prime numbers, relatively prime to each other. So 13 and 12 is also relatively prime. Now go for 7 and 12. Are they relatively prime or not? According to second condition, 7 is prime. If one number is prime, then when it is combined with any other number, they will definitely become the relatively primes to each other. Clear?
You are now unmuted.
So these conditions are checked to identify or to get an idea whether we can apply the CRT theorem on this particular problem or not. So the first condition is you should have congruent equations. Okay. The second condition is the 3 modulus should be different. Okay, it is satisfying. And the third and most important concept is these modulus are they should be relatively prime to each other. Yes, it is also satisfying. So can you apply the CRT algorithm here?
You are now unmuted.
Can you apply the CRT
algorithm?
Can you
apply the CRT algorithm?
Okay. Now tell me, what is step 1? First of all, let me list out A1, A2, A3. What is A1? 3. What is A2? It is again 3. What is A3? 0. What is M1? 7. M2 is 13. M3 is 12. Now the first step is to calculate the value of common modulus M, which is given by M1 multiplied with M2 multiplied with M3. That is equal to 7 into 13 into 12. What is the value of 7 into 13 multiplied with 12? Please respond. Super. It is 1092. You can use the calculators. Nothing wrong in it. And what is step 2? You have to find the values of M1, which is given by M by M1, and M2, which is given by M by M2, and M3, which is given by uppercase M by modulus 3. So what is the value of M1? It is 1092 by 7. What is the value? Find out the value of 1092 by 7.
156.
Super, it is 156. What about M2? 1092 divided by 13. It is 12 sevens are 84. Am I right or not? What about the value of M3? 1092 divided by 12. That is 13 into 7. 91. Now, step 3. Finding the value of M1 inverse. How can you calculate M1 inverse? It is M1 mod M1. Right? It is 156. Mod 7. What is 156 mod 7? What's the value of 156 mod 7? What is the value of M2 inverse? M2 inverse is calculated with the formula M2 mod M2. So it is 84 mod 13. What is 84 mod 13? What is 84 mod 13?
6 sir.
It is 6, right? What about M3 inverse? It is M3 mod M3. So M3 I got it as 91 mod 12. What's the value? 12 sevens are 84, 6 plus 1, 7. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
So finally you have to find the value of x, which is given by a1 m1 m1 inverse plus a2 m2 m2 inverse plus a3 m3 m3 inverse whole modulo operated with capital M. That is equal to, what is the value of a1? It is 3 multiplied with 156 multiplied with 2 plus 3 multiplied with 84 multiplied with 6 plus a3 is 0. So let us remove this one. Mod capital M, what is the value of capital M? 1092. Now tell me, what is the resultant value I will get here? Any idea you have? Now please respond, what is the value we get finally? Please do it and tell me the answer.
1908.
Ma? You give me the entire answer.
1908, sir.
Okay, you modulo operate it with 1092 and give me the answer. What is the value? It is 276. Right. You please check it out, you will get the answer. Is it clear up to this point? Clear?
Yes, sir.
So we'll see the last example, right? Sometimes you may find some puzzles, right? Even in puzzles also you can apply the CRT algorithm. Let us see a simple real-time example where you can apply this CRT algorithm, right? Let us assume that there are n number of friends and they have went for a treasure hunt and they found a box of gold coins, right? Let us assume that there is a box of gold coins. We don't know how many are there, so let us assume that it is having x. And if the gold coins are divided among six friends, there are four coins left over. Similarly, when the same number of gold coins are divided among five friends, only three coins are left over. Left over means nothing but the remainder, right? He is asking us to find out how many coins are left over if the gold coins are divided equally among seven friends. We need to find this one. In order to find the value of this one, when the gold coins are divided among seven friends, the number of gold coins left over is our objective. We need to find it. But before that, we should know what is the value of x. How many gold coins are there inside this box? That is what we need to find. So can I write these equations as first equation? So when it is divided among 6 friends, I get the remainder as 4. So when x is divided among 6 friends, I get the remainder as 4. Therefore, can I write it as x congruent to 4 mod 6? Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
And what about the second equation? If the x coins are divided among 5 friends, right, 3 are left over. Therefore, can I write it as x congruent to 3 mod 5?
Yes, sir.
Right. So these are two different congruent equations and I have different modulus, okay. And if I compare these 6 and 5, they are relatively prime to each other. Now, can I apply the CRT algorithm here?
Yes,
right. Now, solve it. Solve for x. Step 1. Let us take a1 and a2. What is the value of a1? 4. What is the value of a2? 3. What is the value of m1? It is 6. m2 is 5. Now step 1 is to find the common modulus m. M is given by m1 multiplied with m2, that is 6 multiplied with 5, that is equal to 30. Now what is step 2? Finding m1 and m2, where m1 is given by m by modulus m1 and common m2 is given by common modulus divided by modulus 2. So it is 30 divided by what is m1? It is 6, that is equal to 5. Now m2 is 30 divided by 5 is equal to 6. What is step 3 here? What is step 3? Finding m1 inverse. M1 inverse is found by using the equation m1 mod m1. And m2 inverse is to calculate it by using m2 mod m2. What is m1? 5 mod, what is small m1?
6.
6. What is the value?
5.
5.
Now, what is m2 inverse? It is m2, which is 6 mod modulus m2 is 5. What is 6 mod 5?
1, sir.
1. Now, finally, I wish to find the value of x. X is given by a1 multiplied with m1 multiplied with m1 inverse plus a2 multiplied with m2 multiplied with m2 inverse mod capital M. So a1, what is the value of a1? It is 4 multiplied with m1 is 5 multiplied with m1 inverse is again 5. Am I right or not? Plus a2 is 3 multiplied with m2 is 5 multiplied with m2 inverse is 1 mod capital M is 30. So it is, what is the value here? 4, 5 is 20, 25 is 100 plus, what is the value? 3, 5 is 15. Sorry, this is M2 is not this one, right? It is 6, right? Capital M2 is 6. So 3, 6 are 18 into 1, 4, 5, 5, okay, it is 18 mod capital M is 30, 118 mod 30, what is 118 mod 30, anybody please respond?
28, sir.
28. So we have a total of 28 coins in the gold box, right? But that is not our problem. What is that? What is that he is asking? He is asking us when these X coins are divided among seven friends, what is the coins that are left over? So what should I do? I should modulo operate this 28 with 7. So when this 28 is modulo operated with 7, what is the result I will get?
0, sir.
0. That means if the coins are equally distributed among the seven friends, there are no coins that are left over here. That's it. Right? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So you can cross verify whether this the resultant value 28 is satisfying this value or not. You just substitute this x value here. So 28 mod 6. What is 28 mod 6?
4, sir.
4. Right. This is the remainder. And you substitute 28 in this equation. 28 mod 5.
3, sir.
Remainder is 3. Therefore, it is satisfying. Therefore, x is equal to 28 is the correct answer which you got by using the CRT algorithm. Right. So, after finding this x, x is nothing but the number of gold coins in the box. He is asking us to find out whether there are any coins left over when it is equally shared among seven friends. Right. When it is equally shared among seven friends, you are not getting any remainder. Therefore, there are no coins left over when it is divided among seven friends equally. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So, we have seen, sir, three different problems in the CRT. One is a direct question which consists of the congruent equations, where you can apply the same four steps and you can solve it. The second one is when it is given in a sentence format. If some x is divided with some number, you will get the remainder this one. If the same number is divided with some other number, you will get the remainder like this. So that problem we have seen it in the example 2. And the third example what we have discussed is a generic problem where you can apply it for the puzzles like that, right? So this is about the box of gold coins. Example we have seen just now. Right. And other than this solving the congruent equations, we also have another applications. See here. Is this screen visible? Right. So this is the last topic. The applications of CRT. One application we have seen that it is used to solve the quadratic congruence equations. Okay. Right. The example which we have seen is solving the linear quadratic equation. Linear congruence equation where we have only the value of x. You can extend this CRT to solve the quadratic congruence also. Quadratic congruence means we have equations like x square is congruent to a1 mod m1 like this. Here you will have the square. That's why we are calling it as quadratic congruence. Right. So this CRT can be applied to solve the quadratic congruence also. And it is used to represent a very large number in terms of list of small integers. Right. If you have a very large number, you can express it with a list of small integers and you can solve it by using the CRT. Let us see one example on this second application. How we are going to represent a very large number in terms of a list of small integers. Right. So let us have a simple example which is given by the author. Calculate z is equal to x plus y where x is equal to 123 and y is equal to 334. By looking at this, there is no problem, right? 123 plus 334. What is the value you will get? It is 457. This is a simple calculation. But he has given a condition that the system is not allowing the numbers which are greater than 100. That means it is able to store numbers which are less than 100 only. But here if you observe this x, it is 123 which is greater than 100, and this y is 334 which is greater than 100. Therefore, we cannot make use of the computer to solve this. So, in order to solve such type of equations, what I am doing is, I am going to express this x with a list of small integers, right? So, what is the maximum number it can access? It is 99. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
So, if I divide this 123 with 99, what is the remainder I get? 24. And similarly, if I divide this 123 with 98, I get the remainder as 25. If I divide the 123 with 97, I get the remainder as 26. So, I am expressing the same x value 123 with a list of numbers that are less than 100. 24, 99, less than 100. 25, 98, less than 100. 26, 97, less than 100. So, I am expressing a single x value with three congruent equations. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Similarly, you can express the value of y, which is 334, with a list of small numbers less than 100. So, y is equal to 37. When I divide this 334 with 99, I get 37 as the remainder. If I divide this 334 with 98, I get the remainder as 38. 334 divided by 97, remainder is 39. Right. So, here I am, sorry, this is y. So, here I am going to express this y with three congruent equations. But this is not our target. Our target is to find the value of z. Right. Z is equal to x plus y. So, what I will do is, as I have expressed this x with three different congruent equations and y with three different congruent equations, I calculate the first value of z as x plus y. So, I take the first equation, this one from x and this one, I add it. So, 24 mod 99 plus 37 mod 99 is equal to 61 mod 99. Similarly, I take the second two equations, this x from the second equation and y from the second equation. Now, I add it. 25 mod 98 plus 38 mod 98 is 65 mod 98. Similarly, z is equal to x plus y. Take the third equation from x and third equation from y. It is 26 mod 97, 39 mod 97. So, you will get it as 69 mod 97. So, if you solve these equations, then you will get the value of z as 457. So, this particular application we won't find out in any of the concepts that we are going to learn in the future also, but you just put it in mind that you can make use of the Chinese remainder theorem to express a large number with a list of small numbers. Clear?
Yes, sir.
So, in this session, we have gone through a very important concept, that is the Chinese remainder theorem, where we can use this Chinese remainder theorem to solve a list of congruence equations. And you can also use this CRT to solve the quadratic congruence. And this is also used to represent a very large number with a list of small integers, right? We have seen the algorithm. We have gone through three different examples, where the first example is a direct example and the second one is given in terms of statements, how we can convert the statements into the equations. That is what we have learned there. And after that, in general, if you find any puzzles related to this CRT, how you can estimate that it is a CRT problem, all these things we have discussed with three examples. And we have ended our discussion with the applications of CRT. One example on how to express a very large number in terms of small integers. Right. So, this is all about the Chinese remainder theorem, and this is end of today's session. Thank you one and all for joining the session.